We wrap up our four-part series, The Cost of Teaching English. A recent state law required a task force to be set up to come up with a model to teach English to those who speak other languages. That 9-member task force has been at work coming up with a model and could have it finalized in September. The committee submitted its model to the Joint Legislative Budget Committee in June and then had public hearings on it in August. I'll talk to two members of the task force about the ELL educational model, but first, Mike Sauceda tells us about a key component of English language learning, the costs.
Get your black folder, please.
Students coming into John Vreeker's English Learner class at Glendale High School. The students in this class, called ELL Read 180 and English 1-2, are intermediate English learners. Most speak Spanish as their main language, although there is one French speaker in the class. Glendale High is in the Glendale Union High School District, where there are about 1,100 students who are English learners in classes throughout 9 high schools out of a total student population of over 15,000. The Glendale High School District spends more money to educate English learners than it spends on other students.
Our regular students, we spend in the neighborhood of $5,000 on. A regular student being a student that is enrolled in 6 classes that count towards graduation. ELL students, we are spending, in addition to the funding that the state provides us, about $2,200 per student additionally. That's an additional $2.2 million that the district spends for its ELL population.
The English learner classes in the Glendale district are smaller and have a teacher's aide. That's a big portion of the cost.
The most significant cost in the ELL classroom is the staffing. Our ELL classrooms range in size from as low as 13 to 15 students to a teacher and an instructional aide. To classes as large as the one that you viewed today, which had about 24 students in it. Those are our largest ELL classes. And so the student to staff ratio is the biggest expense that we bear. Each classroom has a highly qualified teacher and a highly qualified instructional aide.
There's also training costs for the extra staff.
All of our district staff receive extensive staff development. Our district spends in the neighborhood of $350,000 a year on staff development for all staff, not just ELL staff. But in addition to that, our ELL staff will receive specific training on areas of the ELL classroom. We spend another about $50,000 specifically for them.
Textbooks don't really add a significant cost to teaching English learners. Most of the books are the same used in regular classes, but Dudo says there is about $30,000 to $40,000 in cost for textbooks for ELL classes. Every high school in the district has a Read 180 class named after the special computer system used in the class.
Today you are in the what we call the ELL Read 180 classroom, which is a classroom that combines a reading program along with their English instruction. To set up that classroom cost our district on the average $50,000 per classroom in software and technology to implement the Read 180 program. That's probably the most expensive piece of software and equipment that we have in our ELL program right now.
Another cost that may not be apparent is communication with parents of English learners.
Obviously, with the number of languages you have to deal with, you cannot have on-site interpreters for everything. Our district has had as many as 50 different languages being spoken in our classrooms in 1 year. We have incorporated the use of a service that is called Language Line. The cost to the district is about $10,000 a year for that. That's a base cost. If we go over in our usage, then there are additional fees we have to pay.
Most of the money for the extra costs associated with teaching kids English comes from a special property tax the district is allowed to levy for desegregation. Only 19 of Arizona's more than 200 school districts can do that. The district does receive $370 on top of the $2,200 it spends to educate English learners, but for the schools that receive just the state funding and don't have other sources of revenue like the Glendale District, teaching ELL kids can be tough.
Well, they have to do it under the state funding formula, and so you, the most common way of funding an unfunded mandate is raising class sizes. You increase class sizes, you cut back on the number of staff you need, and that gives you funds then for adding programs in other areas. And so your regular classes become more and more crowded.
Here now to talk about the ELL model are two members of the panel working on the project, Jean Garcia and Margaret Garcia Dugan. Garcia is a vice president for education partnerships for Arizona State University. Garcia Dugan is deputy superintendent of public instruction for Arizona. Welcome to you both.
Thank you for having us.
Jean Garcia, let's talk about some of the basics. There is a requirement of 4 hours a day. Tell us about that.
Well, this is a legislative requirement. In other words, I think the legislature passed on this issue. And so what concerns me in the 4 hours is that it's really not a research-based time frame. A legislature and its wisdom determined that was the case, but some kids will come to the enterprise, that is to learn English and learn English in school, with different backgrounds, different abilities in English, different abilities in the primary language, previous educational experiences, good teachers, bad teachers in the previous years. So setting one set of time period, 4 hours, seemed to me somewhat capricious. And so I think that this is a problem with the time limit.
Margaret, what's your response to that?
Well, my response is in 2000, Proposition 203 was passed, and the law really required that students, English language learners, be placed in a structured English immersion classroom. Now, that to me probably meant all day. The task force with the new legislation of House Bill 2064 has mandated at least a minimum of 4 hours, so you could go more than 4 hours if you'd like. So I think there's a little bit of flexibility for the schools. So 4 hours of English language development, and I think with a very structured sequential program, our students can learn the English in 4 hours during the day, and then the other 2 hours, flexibility to take physical education, mathematics, art, some other classes that they might want to do. They call them specials in the elementary, they call them electives at the high school. So I really believe that you need to have at least a set amount of time. I think 4 hours is a good number to choose, although if people want to go all day, I think the more, it's this whole thing on time on task, the longer you stay on a task, you're probably going to learn it faster and probably more efficiently. So I think we're given flexibility either 4 hours or all day, no longer than a year, then they become mainstreamed with the regular ed students.